ko Ranginui ke Runga, ko Papatūānuku kei Raro, ko ngā tangata kei Wanganui, ti hei Māori Ora. Kei te mihi ahau I te mātua nui I te rangi, nana nei ngā mea katoa. I ngā karangaranga maha, I te whānau, whānui, I te iwi whānui, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. Ko Taranaki te maunga, ko Waitara te awa, ko Muru Raupatu rawa ko o tākau oku mārai, ko Te Atiawa rawa ko Ngaitahu oku iwi, ko Raniere Erihana rawa ko Nani Wala o oku tūpana, ko Megan Tamati-Quennell taku ingoa. So kia ora and welcome. I want to quickly hand over to Nigel and for him to introduce himself rather than me do it on his behalf and the way he kind of chooses to do it. Thank you.
You stay there because you're going to be up there again in a sec. As you can see, it's going to be quite a fluid talk. Ngā mihi nui ki a koutou katoa ko Nigel Borell ahau, nō tauranga moana au, ngō Ngaitarangi, ko Ngaitarangi Ngāti Rangi nui me te whakatohia oku iwi, ko Paparō te marae, ko Mawau te maunga, nō reira tēnā rā koutou katoa. Done.
Done. Okay. So...
Oh, here we go.
I'm sitting down now. And we coordinated our outfits. Not, we just happened to wear the same thing. It made me laugh, that whole thing about curators only wearing black.
And gold.
And gold. Thanks, Arifa. So, kia ora, Nigel. Firstly, Nigel, I wanted to congratulate you on an extraordinary show. Toi Tū Toi Ora. I think it's the second contemporary Māori art show ever to fill an entire gallery. The first being Kōhia ko Taikaka Anaki, Artists Construct New Directions at the National Art Gallery in Wellington, which opened 30 years ago on the 1st of December in 1990. And interesting, in that show, people like you, Peter, were in that show when still at art school. People like Shane Cotton were first in there. Mike P, there's a whole lot of people. Anyway, it was an interesting show. It was quite a different show to this show, and I'd kind of like to touch on the differences later. But I wanted to start by asking you, can you firstly outline the curatorial premise for Toi Tū Toi Ora?
Yeah, I suppose the curatorial premise for Toi Tū was really trying to tackle two things. The dilemma of representing a large body of artists accurately, with integrity, and in a way that allowed their nuanced voices and investigations to still breathe and be visible. And the other dilemma was, how do you unify those voices, or how do you present something that unifies them and shows that unity? And you might say they're sort of at odds with one another, but they really aren't. So for me, the creation story was this really founding way of thinking about describing our place on the earth, our place not on the earth, our place in being, and also repositioning mātauranga Māori and Māori ways of seeing the world as the first conversation that we engage with, not just about art, but about being Māori and Māori culture. And no matter who you are as an artist or as a Māori person, there is a place for you in that spectrum of thinking that your ideas and your way of seeing that world can resonate. And so for me, that was the ultimate truth. That was the ultimate offer for the show, is to think about how we can describe a sense of ourselves where we see our collective selves and our individual selves as related statements, and it was quite profound. So when that sort of dawned on me, it was a relief. It was like, oh, I think that makes sense, that works. And I did trial it out on a few people to make sure of that.
I'll talk about that too.
But it also got quite profound rather quickly when you started to see that picture and that blueprint of how we all are connected. And again, we didn't need visual arts to tell us that, our pursuit as artists. It was our pursuit as Māori that told us that. So yeah, was pretty much that in a nutshell.
So you've probably answered my next question, which was really what was the key proposition for the show and some of the conceptual drivers, perhaps the ones that aren't seen. Can you?
Yeah, so, you know, beyond that and layered within that whole proposition and way of framing, it naturally speaks back to certain assumptions about what that means. What does a survey show mean? What does it mean to organise it around time? What does it mean to organise it from point A, B, C, and say, actually, you know what, let's park that and think about a Māori way of thinking about those ideas. And the creation story is the ultimate journey through an investigation of time. And when you do that, it's timeless, it's placeless, and it's limitless. And so all those ideas started to resonate in really profound ways for me. And it was about suspending this sort of reliance, this sort of nagging reliance on Western chronology and Western frameworks to describe our way in the world. And often that has to be the first conversation that we have to navigate, and I just think it's not. And this show is living proof that it's not. And it's living proof that our ways of seeing the world, they're enough. They're enough not just for us, but for the rest of the world to sort of think, hey, there's another way to think and theorise and understand art and being. And guess what? It's directly related to these lands, to these shores, and to this place in the world.
So you've articulated some of the kind of the big themes, but there were also sub themes, and I'm going to raise something now, that are perhaps not apparent. One was being prophecy and provocation that we discussed when you were developing the show, and which I thought should be the focus for the show. Prophecy being related to vision, and provocation related really to change and innovation, and those two kind of positions that people kind of occupy often, particularly Māori artists.
Way to get that in there, Megan.
Yeah. Can't let them get away with that. Can you talk about some of the sub-themes which run through the exhibition but are not kind of instantly obvious?
Yeah, it's quite layered, and curating this show has been really a test in storytelling. It's been a test in how you take people on a journey, those both familiar and those both unfamiliar with the territory that they're about to tread. And so the creation story and the frameworks that sit within that as a foundation, as an introduction statement, they need to scaffold up in a way that anyone can enter that conversation and understand it or be embraced by it. And within that, it started to become clearer that it wasn't just about the creation story, it was about the way in which we order time, the way in which we order knowledge, the way in which we order the world. So the realms of Ida Tangata, the human realm, and the realm of Ida Atua, the realm of the gods, you know, that's told in Kauairunga and Kauairaro in terms of the whare wānanga. And it was like, oh my God, these ideas are not new. And all I'm really doing is investing in what we already know to be true and putting them in, contrasting them in the establishment of the fine arts institution, where we know it can be quite a fraught space, where knowledge is quite a contested idea, even within the academy. So, you know, placing it within that context was in itself a way of speaking to that and articulating it. And it became a way of representing it. So the ground floor being the Ida Atua, the realm of the gods, where we do not exist, but we relate to. And then the level one being the Ida Tangata space and the pursuits of humankind, and all our stories became, scaffold around that framework, yeah.
Awesome. I was also interested in how Toi Tū Toi Ora evolved, and if the show that we see now for example, is the show that you initially conceived?
Yeah, it evolved because when I applied for the job in 2015, they asked you to interview to pitch three shows that you would bring. And one of the shows that I pitched was a survey show because, and it wasn't because I was trying to impress them. Well, maybe I was. Maybe I was. But it was really like, this is so needed. I was an emerging artist in those shows. And Saffron Te Ratana, Reuben Patterson, Ngāti Taiapa, we were all emerging artists in those shows. And I know firsthand what they did for me in my career and how they helped me see myself in that story and own that story. So, hang on a sec. Yeah, we're good. No, we're good. There's going to be moments like that throughout the whole day, people. So, you know. So it was just elemental that we had to do that for the next generations. And 20 years, there's been two generations of artists that have come through that have not been given that platform, that ability to be seen within the canon, within the establishment, within the New Zealand art story. So it's hugely political, it's hugely important, and it was already then, in 2015, it was needed. So the idea was to follow through with that, and that's where it started. Ask me that question again, because there was something in it.
Is the show we see now see, for example, the show you initially conceived? Because, yeah, you know, as you evolve an exhibition, things change, things drop, things move,
yeah,
you refine it, you know, you...
By and large it is. By and large it still is the show, which I'm really proud about because it sort of says that it had the wherewithal, it had the rigour to, and it was enduring, because it's not just enduring for the little footprint that I was working on, it's been enduring for all our ancestors and our cultural beliefs from beginning of time. So for me it was like, well, what will it matter if it, you know, fits within this little window of a show? But really it just refined itself in terms of being too ambitious. I mean, you might think this is ambitious, but it was originally...
It was larger.
And so there was some real, just real common sense refining that you do. It's like making an artwork. You refine your ideas if you're clever. You refine your ideas.
If you're clever.
And you hone them and you shape them until you feel that they that there are no holes, there's no gaps. And that's the work of storytelling, not curating. That's the work of storytelling. And that's what I did. And I had really good advice from people. And you, like art making, you have a small circle of people that you share your ideas with that give you honest feedback. Sometimes too honest, but it's all good. It's all needed, and it's all necessary, and that happened. But also, the real important reason for the show is that contemporary Māori art has been very invisible on the scene. It's been very disparate. It's been happening in pockets over here, over there, but we've never done what we've just done in the last 2 days and see each other connected, celebrating our place and repositioning Māori art at the centre. Māori art is the only art form in this country that could not exist anywhere else. It's the unique art form of this place. And this exhibition is about reinstating that position and that statement, not just within the canon or within this institution, but within our own thinking. So that's what it's about.
So you've stolen one of my questions, which was, what is it to be the centre rather than the margins, to quote old Rangi Pānuhu? What is it to be the centre, you know, in this show? Because it is obviously the centre.
Yeah, it's to be empowered. It's to tell your story through your voice and to feel confident and assured that it matters. It's about being knowing that the knowledge that sits behind what you have to say is worth saying. Knowing that the knowledge that you have to say is important, and knowing what you have to share is unique. And it's all of those things that we can remind ourselves about when we are at the centre. But it's also about not having to second guess what you're doing on the planet, you know what I mean? That's what we should all be invested in, no matter who we are and what we're from. We should be invested in our own centre, our own universe, and for Māori, it's an individual but also a collective aspiration. And so, you know, for me, it does that heavy lifting around re-centering. And re-centering you have to do it in your own head first. You can't expect to see it. If you can't imagine it, then you're not going to see it. So if you're not brave enough to imagine that future, then you're not going to manifest it. So we have to be up for the challenge of manifesting it.
I wanted to ask where the name of the show came from and when it arrived, and were there previous names for the show or other things that you kind of thought about or tried out?
Yeah, I named the show.
As you should, it's yours.
And I'm not a linguist, and I know I've got friends that are, and it's like, well, should I ask them? It's like, nah, I'm not going to ask them.
Good job.
And it was as simple as that statement that, you know, Toi Tū is really quite simply a way of getting to the point of saying Māori art, standing tall, standing strong, and that was enough. And the show will do the rest. And really it was about claiming that statement and owning it, like I say, not just in my head, now with everyone else, and saying these artists are going to show you how it's claimed and how it's presented through their work, and collectively we're going to own it. So, you know, that's really in a nutshell where that came from, and it was just about getting from A to B in terms of statement and intent.
Joyce, you talked in the media launch for the show on Friday about contemporary Māori art being collective, being a collective and connected movement, and describe Māori art in a way that I would, which I liked, being nuanced and diverse, so there's nothing kind of predictable in there. Do you feel that cohesion as a collective and connected movement gave momentum to this exhibition in a way you expected, or has it been different than that?
Yeah. No, it's just highlighted something I've always thought. I've been, you know, privileged to do a range of different things within community, working on wharenui, on meeting houses with Paki Harrison as a youngster. I worked on three houses under him, not as a carver, as a painter and a muralist, and I saw firsthand the power of working collectively and the power of leadership within mobilising collective practice. I saw it in my high school teacher, Hori Pōmana, when I was at high school, and I saw it in Te Atinga when I was part of that group. That idea of working collectively and working in a way where everyone's visible and part of the story and part of the contribution is a powerful thing. So I knew that was going to work. But I suppose it's just making good on the fact that working collectively is the only way to approach it, and to seeing our collective strength does not mean that we don't have individual ways of seeing ourselves or articulating it. I think that's a misnomer, that, you know, you can't be an individual within a collective. And we talked that's definitely one of the sections of the show, is that you can have individual things to say. Look, I'm a twin. I've got a twin sister. 2 minutes older than me, but we have very different views on certain things as Māori people. And there's very similar ones that in other times, but, you know, the fact is that we can still have an individual voice as Māori and a united one at the same time. Yeah.
You've talked about how you intentionally created the show within a Māori frame of reference and a Māori worldview and narrative, and outside of the canon of the mainstream art history. But do you feel this show still traverses like a Māori art history? Because it features 70 years worth of contemporary art practice and many generations of artists from some of the founding ones, who foundational people who kind of broke the ground, the Māori internationals, as Jonathan would call them, and then a younger generation of artists, also other people, you know, like you have, we have our kaihanga uku people in there, our adornment people in there. So do you think that it still, that traverses what we'd call a Māori art history?
Yeah, I think it's still there. I think all that history is still there. It's just not been privileged as the first conversation. So, you know, often in institutions such as this, the Māori conversation is always second to the art canon. And it's time to just turn that around and see what it looks like to have a Māori gaze on the world as the first conversation. That one's still there. It's not going anywhere, but it's still there, and it will still be had in different ways. But we're going to privilege this one first. You know, when I talked at the beginning about the integrity of artists' intentions and their inspiration, it also speaks to that you can push the boat out, but you have to be realistic about the nuanced nature of what they're looking at and be true to their own investigations. But let's just privilege the Māori worldview and lens first. It's not going to hurt a bit, you know?
So, and kind of building on that, I wanted to again give a kind of shout out to Rangi Pānoho, who is a Māori art historian who referred in his book Māori Art History, Architecture, Landscape and Theory, which is huge. Like the Māori art history, he called it a toi tāhuhu. Is that a term that you would use and apply, or do you think there's a different concept or idea that you would work with?
Yeah, I applaud any Māori thinker for creating a framework to describe those stories, because we need them, we need more of them, and we need more of us to own our theoretical space and our philosophical space, and to name it and to share it. I mean, that's all any other theorist is doing, but for some reason we feel that our own are not valid, and we've just got to get over that and just own the space. For me, I like other theoretical ideas. Doesn't mean I agree with them, or doesn't mean I'm living by them, but if they're a means to an end to understanding it differently at this point in time, that's good enough. That's what we need. And we need more Māori writers, more curators, more thinkers invested in shaping other theoretical ways of seeing the world. This is just one. This is just one. And, you know, Rangi Pānoho's is just one, but, and Ngāti no Alice and Deirdre Brown's will be another with their big research. But there's room for more. There's room for all of them.
Bob's is another.
Bob's is another. And when you do yours, yours will be another too.
I've done mine for 30 years.
But yeah, there's heaps of room for a lot.
I was going to say, for me, there's many gems in that show, but some of the works that stand out for me personally are some of the founders of the contemporary Māori art movement. Those Māori modernist artists, because you know that's my thing, I really enjoy all of that. And works that have not really been seen before. Those amazing ceramics by Selwyn Wilson, which you told me came out of someone's garden, family's garden. Mary Lodge's bronzes upstairs, which blew my head off. Katerina Matida's paintings, Elizabeth Ellis's paintings. You know, Cliff Whiting's work, which we don't get to see often, you know, as individual work. And I was completely taken, of course, being of and from Pariaka, like other people in this room, of, well, Naina's, of course, but also Selwyn's from 1977, to see those two paintings. To me, all of that was really exciting. So I wanted to talk about, absolutely exciting, really knocked my socks off. I wanted to talk about those relationships and the loan of those works that really support or rely on the support and generosity of those artists and often their whānau, you know, and they're very personal relationships And in terms of curatorial practice, between an artist and a curator or an artist's family, they're relationships of trust. So with 111 artists in the exhibition, that's a lot of relationships to kind of manage and look after. How was that process, and were there others like Tarati and Brooke, who are sitting up here, and other members of the gallery staff who also looked after some of those relationships, which are, we know, are so important?
Yeah, no, I'm really rapt to hear you say those moments, you know, had that impact, because that's what we were after. We were after, well, you know, it's a bit like shopping, and anyone who knows me knows I'm a good shopper. We wanted to unearth the works that are hardly ever seen, or might have been seen in black and white photographs, or have just gone to ground, and where are they? And so I do have to acknowledge Tarati and Brooke, because the three of us were just doggedly ringing people. We were doggedly ringing people and hassling people, and then looking through phone books, it might be that person, give them a ring. They live in Gisborne, it might be that person. And it worked. And sometimes it didn't. And that's, you just gotta be, you gotta, you know, if you want it in the show, you gotta go ask. And then some of those times we get to go visit. And so with Media Lodge and her older sister, Katerina Mataida, it was about going and visiting Katerina's husband, Junior, and in the Waikato. And that was special for all of us, because not only did we get to see Katerina's house and her whānau, but we got to see in the flesh four really impressive paintings of hers. And we all saw them and went, oh my God, we need all four of these in the show. One of them I'd only seen in a black and white photograph, and it's just special. So, you know, it's sort of, it goes without saying, it's like we're going to get, you know, if they're up for it, we need these works in the show, because you all, we all need to be reconnected with their brilliance and their work and their legacy. And often it's the women that are invisible in that story from that generation. So again, as a younger of a female twin, and knowing my place, it was about, actually, we need to reinstate that story. We need to get them visible. Even when they were like, no, I don't want to be in the show, I said, no, you have to be in the show. But sorry.
Sorry about
that. And that is Media Lodge and Elizabeth Ellis. It's like, no, I want you in the show. And then they would send me images. They would go into the garage, dust things off. What about this? I said, what else you got? What about this? So can I please put those in? So, and that's just a taster of what they've got. So just wrapped. I'm wrapped that we were able to do that. I'm wrapped that we were able to put John Havell in this exhibition.
Absolutely.
I'm wrapped that we were able to talk with Salwyn's son, one in England by email, and then one in Wellington, around two of those famous works from the Pariaka series.
Which are amazing.
And put them in pride of place in the show, and have him represented. You know, this if this show is meant to be important, then we've got to do our best to try and unearth those signature works and get them in the exhibition. And just wrapped, you know, that was quite a win, a real quiet win for all of us. And they're not so quiet when you get to see the show, which is cool, because it makes all that hard work worth it. But
I also felt the show's really inclusive, and that you made some important decisions, and you touched on it lightly just a minute ago, about ensuring that Māori women artists were really seen and given an opportunity. For example, Emi Karaka's epic paintings in the atrium were commissioned. Charlotte down at, you know, that satellite project down at Britain Art. You know, Maureen and Mata Aho's amazing installation, which is a real triumph, I think, of the show. Lonnie's work at Britain Art, Naina's work, which is so strong, Aisha's, Jacqueline Fraser, Robin Kahuki, Toi Maihi, Nova Paul, Marie Shen, you know, Anna Itti's new commission that I know Natasha had lots to do with or supported, you know, all of those things. Can you talk to me about your thinking around that, making sure that that was kind of present?
Well, they're just good Māori artists. And they deserve to be seen. And, you know, history has not treated them well in their storytelling. and they've been, it's been a bit of a marginal one. So with 111 there was room for everybody, but there was also room to rewrite and rebalance some of that visibility. I was keen to do that, but I was also keen to see the work I wanted to see in the show. You know, so you're presenting the show that you want to see.
Yeah.
And that you want others to be, to experience. But also as a curator and as a Māori male, there were certain topics and ideas that I felt the woman needed to lead. And Maureen Lander and Mata Aho Collective, it was important for me. And we talked about this in this very room when we first pitched to them, the commission, that it's important that as women, they lead the story about the most formidable woman in our narratives in Hine Nui Te Pō. And perhaps through a female gaze, lift the nonsense around how she's been vilified and sort of seen as some sort of crazy woman in certain narratives. And I tell you what, there's, yeah, that interpretation and the way they've presented this, her story is holistic. It's poetic and it's punchy in ways that only women could tell. So that was about, as a male, understanding your own place, not just as a Māori male, but as a male, understanding your place and allowing them to tell their story.
I also wanted to add to that, you managed to ensure, as well as being part of a narrative of the exhibition, individual artists get good focus within the exhibition. You know, you've got Mike P with his elephants, that lovely work Ascension, his three Poor Man, Beggar Man, Thief work. Peter appears in a number of sites within the exhibition with really strong, extraordinary work. The same with Brett Graham down the hallway, John Miller's photographs. But there's also like three works by Shona to Peter Davies. Good representation of people like Nikki Moore, Matthew McIntyre Wilson, Wee Taiapa, Manos Nathan, Bay Riddell. And I was also really pleased to see Sandy Adsett's window work, you know, that he flanks the exhibition, which I thought was an amazing touch, and that beautiful series of works which really highlight him and his amazing command of colour. I don't know if we've seen his work together like that before. I wanted to ask, did you have in mind what works you wanted for the show? You've talked about that in terms of the loans, but did you also work with artists and institutions and kind of where you've loaned works, but about and talk to the artists about how they wanted to be represented in the show, for example?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there are moments in the show where everyone gets to shine, and I think that was important to me, that we honour the magnitude of their ideas and what they've offered, and that they get a chance to be presented in that. I also wanted moments where artists could, you know, be represented again in ways that weren't shoehorning them into certain ways. And I met with Michael, Shane, Peter, some of those guys, just to make sure that they were okay with my thinking around placing their work. And they were all very embraced and encouraged and encouraging of me of carrying on with it and seeing it through. So that was important to me as a Māori curator, to make sure that I am not misrepresenting someone's ideas, but perhaps lifting the lid on a layer of idea that sits there that often gets overlooked by the mainstream because they don't know how to tap into it. They don't know how to understand that layered, heavy idea that's sitting just under the surface. And so we get a chance to pull it to the top in the show.
Choice. I also wanted to talk about the satellite project, the commissions at Britain Art, with Shane Cotton, which is stunning, Lonnie Hutchinson's, Lionel Grant and Tim Grucci, and Charlotte Graham's. Which I think is so good to have work outside of the gallery and in such a prime location, not just within the gallery. I wanted to talk about that project and those commissions and how that kind of came about.
Yeah. Charlotte Graham, actually. Charlotte had an exhibition down there 2 years ago, Charlotte. And she worked with Jeremy Hansen, and she introduced me to Jeremy when I went to have a look at the site. And I said to Jeremy, just quite off the cuff, hey, we're working on this big contemporary Māori art show, would you be interested in partnering? And he instantly said yes, and we just kept working on it since. And there is not a maverick, but there is that ability and that element to the show where you just have to ask questions. If you want things to happen, you have to be up for the conversation of creating it and seeing if it will fly with people. And we did that a lot with the show, where it got bigger, it got vaster just through having conversations and walking with people around how we might do it together. And Jeremy was definitely part of that with Britomart Group, and then we sold it to Peter Cooper, and Peter Cooper loved it and put a lot of funding and impetus behind making sure that it was a strong feature. And you know, the institution and the footprint of the show is huge, and I get all that, but unless we can see it out there, you know, it's also different when you can see it out there in the landscape beyond the institution. It takes on a different meaning and a different presence, and a different, you're conscientious in a different way about Māori art. So it was really cool to use and to team up with the Britomart site. Mm.
You said this exhibition was 4 years in the making, and is a show that came with you when you took up the position at Auckland Art Gallery. Can you, how significant has realising this exhibition been to you personally?
Mm.
Sorry. Just
bloody hell,
just
Megan.
Sorry, just trying to get in there.
I mean, it's hugely rewarding. I'm so humbled and rapt and relieved, proud that I could be the catalyst to just bring it to the surface. That's what I've done. And I know that sounds overly humble, but really that's all I've done, is just bring the conversation to the surface so that we can do what we're doing today, and we can see it, we can enjoy it, we can celebrate it, we can be encouraged to see further. So where does this take us? Where do we want to go from here? It's important we do that, yeah.
Would you do it again?
No way.
No. And if you did, would you do it differently?
Yeah, I probably would do it differently, because I think one of the reasons I now know why we haven't had another survey show is it's because Taketake did it. She was like, you know what, I don't want to do that again. I can understand that fully right now, and there are other things to want to try and do and achieve. So and there's also other voices that can have a go at telling that story differently. You know, just like our theoretical research and discussions with how we think about Māori art, we've got to allow space for other people to share their vision for what Māori art could be in their time. This is my time to tell the story how I want to tell it. But if I'm wise, the thing is to know that there'll be a time when someone else needs to tell their story. Our story in the way that they see it, yeah. And hopefully that will happen in due course, yeah.
Okay, so I'm just gonna poke you a little bit more. Can you talk about your own relationship to Māori art and your role as a curator and how you see that?
Mm. Māori art saved my life.
And mine.
When I went through school, I passed two subjects, art and English. And I was, you know, termed a slow learner and all that stuff. Yeah. And they asked me to go back and do second year six, and I said, oh God, no, I'm not doing that. I only want to do the art subjects. Can't I just go back and do art and English and yada yada? I said, no, you need to pass three subjects. So I left school early. And I went out into the wide world. I went to AUT and I studied art and did fabric design and screen printing. And my very first tutor was Jean Clarkson, who was here on Friday at the opening. And that journey sort of led me on my discovery that art was, Māori art was the voice that spoke to me, that gave me a sense of pride, a sense of confidence, a sense of standing. And so I went on to work on meeting houses after that, under Paki Harrison and Peter Boyd, and then it was Peter Boyd, you know, another a great mentor, who said to me one day, you need to go and do this art program. I said, I don't know, I've got a twin sister and she's a bright spark, she can do all that university stuff. And I didn't think it was even a path that I could recognise. So it was through the arts that I've found my feet and found my voice, but perhaps through a way in which isn't conventional, but perhaps is everyone's story. You know, we've all come to it in different ways. And so that was the way I came to the art journey. And looking back on it, I was really privileged and lucky to work with Paki Harrison and Peter Boyd, and then go to art school, and then go to art school and be embraced by Robert Yonke and Kura Tuarurewiri and Shane Cotton, and see the other side of the coin. So I got the best of both worlds, and it just set me up to have a really... I just realised too that a lot of the crap that we deal with is just nonsense. You know, we deal with a lot of nonsense, and we cater to a lot of nonsense that coming to education as a second chance learner, you see it for what it is when you're out in the wide world as a young person, and you realise that some things are important and some things aren't, and you get good at understanding what those things are and not worrying about the crap so much, but worrying about what you're interested in. So that life learning was part of, yeah, just fine-tuning my vision for what I wanted to do and be. Thanks for pulling that up, Megan.
I also wanted to ask, do you feel like as an art maker, you've got a different approach to curating than someone like me, for example, who was a weaver and a kind of wannabe filmmaker, but not a painter or a visual artist as such? Do you feel like that brings a different dimension to your curatorial practice?
Absolutely, and I'm really proud of the difference that it brings, because a little bit like, you know, when I talked about what understanding how to differentiate the crap from the stuff that you want to do, in a slightly different sort of way, being an artist, I can differentiate the art institution and fine-tune the focus using that same approach, whereby I'm not part of the baggage of art history, because that was never part of my training and my knowledge. And so it's given me actually a clarity about what it is that I want to do and see and be, and what I want to present and do. So that's been, I've really loved that, because while I don't mind the gamut, you know, and I really have great conversations with colleagues that have an art history background, I don't have that. I have a lived one. I have a lived Māori art experience, and a living one, where it's always been shaped by the arts community. I'm not a curator. I'm an artist, and that's my first voice, is a visual artist. So I look at everything with that lens, and curating is actually about storytelling and about how you present these stories, but also about how you undergo that research and the integrity that you bring to that research.
Yeah, so I talked at the beginning about kōhē ko taikaka anaki, when we started this conversation, about how 30 years ago it was a contemporary Māori art show that filled the entire gallery at the National Gallery in Wellington. That show was instigated by Tim Walker, and the resources and space were handed over to Ngāpuna Waihanga, and Toi Māori to kind of curate. It was initially supposed to be Sandy Adset and Paratini Matchett to curate it, but it ended up being mostly Para, who was then the chair of Ngāpuna Waihanga. How do you feel this show differs with you as an institutional curator? And even though you've just said you're not a curator, I would beg to differ. And a Māori art curator inside Toi O Tamaki.
Yeah, institutional curating for Māori is very tricky. It's a tricky landscape. and you can be quite feel quite divided with your loyalties and your abilities to want to see protocol and cultural practice adhered to in a safe and robust and appropriate way with what an institution sees as a bottom line. And I don't think that's not just unique to this institution, that's most Māori's journey within this country and within this landscape. But I think, you know, institutional curating has its good and bad days. you know, it's good days that you have the momentum and the resource behind you to execute something as extravagant, as imaginative and as outrageous as this exhibition is. And without the institution, you don't. So, you know, there are two sides to that. You can't think imaginatively if you don't have the scaffolding to help make that happen and the supporters to help make that happen. So there's that side to it. The other is there's always negotiation and navigating, and sometimes you have to compromise on how you shape, and then sometimes you don't. So you've got to pick your battles in that regard, in terms of the things that you've got to hold fast on or hold your ground on in terms of the storytelling. And perhaps in relation to, you know, Ngāpuna Waihanga and Sandy, they're scary characters. They would have scared the bejesus out of some of those guys down there. But also they were independent voice, so they had the ability to say what they wanted, unfettered by being a part of the institution or worrying about what the ramifications of that might be. And there's a place for that type of curating, I think, because that independent voice is going to present stories in a way that the institutional voice just can't quite intersect sometimes, and I think that's healthy, yeah.
So another question, how do you see Māori art curatorial practice in a much broader terms? How do you see that or understand it?
I see it as really vital, as a vital conduit to telling our stories and to rebalancing how we think about art histories and speaking back to those art histories that we know don't represent us or don't actually cover that idea, not just well, accurately, or at all. And, you know, there's an important job for us to play in that. And, you know, perhaps unpacking who and what a curator is still important in doing that, so that we feel we can all have a go at that, whatever that might mean. Okay, you may not have a go at it here, but we might have a go at it. When I first had a go at it, I did it at my community art gallery at Nathan Homestead in Manurewa, and it was a Matariki exhibition, and it wasn't that long ago. So, you know, having a go at it is underrated and needs to be supported, and is important. I see Margaret Orr doing curating a lot these days, and I see lots of my colleagues who are artists actually having a go at storytelling through curatorial practice. And we need to unpack that. What does that mean for us? Not for the institution or the establishment or the history of curating, but what does it mean for Māori to be the author and to be the orchestrator of ideas?
Choice. So that brings me to the next one. Second to last. I know there's a catalogue or publication to come with Toi Tū Toi Ora. Can you talk a little bit about the publication, please?
Yeah. The publication. So COVID's been tricky, of course, for everyone. We've been working with Penguin Random House on a very large book, and it's ambitious like the show. And it's probably needed, just like the show. But there's a range of voices in there, and there's a reiterating of what you see in the exhibition. but maybe articulating some of the politics, some of the nuanced nature of Māori art in more explicit ways are taking place in the book. There are voices such as Moana Jackson, who speaks to Māori knowledge and the place of storytelling in our culture. There is the voice of Robert Yonke. There is the voice of Jolene Rickard and her view of Te Māori and its importance as a Native American artist and a scholar who witnessed the power of that show in her own people's lands, and what it did for curatorial practice for their people. So it was because of shows like that that the American institutions actually even saw their Indigenous people and their practices as worthy of being given a voice. And she talks about that in the book. And to me, that's a revelation, because we often talk about Te Māori and its importance to us, but we forget that actually it was important to other Indigenous people where that exhibition was being displayed and opened. So there's a range of things. There's probably too many things at the moment that we're trying to say in the book. But Tārati also makes a huge contribution to offering a chronological timeline of Māori art exhibitions in that book. So we're hoping that it will be a useful resource for art schools, for ourselves, and just again to rebalance how we think about art histories and what they might mean here.
And my very final question, Nigel, thank you for being so full with all your answers, is what's next?
Daddy holiday is what's next. I'm having a break over summer. As my twin said, you need to clean your room.
And that's not a metaphor.
You need to clean your room. We need to work on the house, and we need to just connect with all of you people a bit more than I've done in the last 4 years. Take some time to enjoy this and to allow it to do the work of seeing ourselves, and perhaps sometimes seeing ourselves differently in this institution. Yeah, that would be enough right now.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well done, Megan.
Beautiful. Well done, you.
So I think we have 15 minutes for questions, if anyone wants to ask anything, or, yeah, feel free.
I think I asked them all.
I think you did ask them all.